While they're going, I want to take just a second to say I'm glad summer's about over. We'll be glad to see a lot of our folks that have been traveling be back with us and in our worship services. But I want to let you know about a special service coming up. We've all seen the news and the horrific things that are taking place with, seems like our law enforcement officers have become targets of evil. And so I know there were some events yesterday or Friday, where we met at the flagpole for some prayer, praying for our peace officers, our law enforcement officers, but also rang the bell at 11 o'clock. Several things that were going on actually all across our country. A lot of us were wearing blue last Friday. But we just got to feeling like we needed to do something else. There was something more needed here. And this is not to take the focus off of God. As a matter of fact, you will find that the week that I'm getting ready to tell you about, very much God-focused. But on September the 27th, the last Sunday of the month of September, we are in the process of inviting our Iowa Park police officers and their families to be our special guest, along with Sheriff's Department officers that work in this area, DPS officers that work in this area, and our game wardens that work this area, to be our guests. And we'll have an area for them to sit so that they will be together. We're hoping they will be in uniform, those that are in uniform. And we're going to honor them in our service. And again, this is not elevating them to the level of God by any means, but they need to hear that we're behind them. And as I've been studying, and I'll go ahead and tell you now, it will not be an original outline, because I started thinking, how do you preach a sermon for something like that? I thought of several passages, but it would be taking it out of context, and I'm not willing to do that. But I found another pastor that had a great outline, so I'm going to take his outline, and we'll put my sermon on it, and we're going to have it for that day. And then as a church, we won't have a church-wide meal, but the church will be providing a meal for those law enforcement officers and their families across the street after the service. So be praying about September the 27th and be here to let them see that we support them in the work they're doing in protecting us and providing and laying their lives on the line each time they put that uniform on. So that's coming up on the 27th. I know you'll be excited about that also. Well, we are starting a new series today entitled, Where Are the Solomons Today? You say, how long is the series going to be? I don't know. I'm still writing. It'll be 3 or 4 weeks minimum. But we'll work through this, and then we're trying to decide where God wants us to go after this. So I want you to do something for me this morning. I want you to imagine for just a moment that you're in a time of personal worship of God. Prayer, whatever you do in your personal worship time where you're alone, you're worshiping God. Now, you've been here and you've heard the sermon, so you're taking seriously the call to return to God, to return to your first love, Jesus Christ. You've taken serious the call to return to prayer and to return to God's word and unity in the task. You understand that you are to contend for the faith, as Jude told us. But you realize that that is a huge undertaking. I mean, it is almost a daunting task before you. Then you think of those before you and you go, you know, there's a lot of people that have tried this and failed. But I remind you, there are also many who you will be following their footsteps, and they are what we might call the giants of the faith, men and women of God, who have been described as men and women after God's own heart. Now, you're in this personal worship time, and God comes to you, and in this personal worship time, He tells you, He makes this statement to you. He says, tell me, what do you want me to give you? Think about that question for a minute, because most of the time, I know in my years of being a Christian, I've been taught that I ought to take my life and give it like a blank check to God and let Him fill in the blanks. The answer is yes, and just He fills in the blanks, and God, I'll do whatever you want me to do. But in this instance, It is almost like God giving you a blank check and saying, okay, as you worship me, I'm saying, here, you fill it out. What do you want me to do for you? You got to be careful. I mean, we've seen that commercial where the guy gets this question asked, what do you want if you can? He has this little genie, and I'm by no means saying God is a genie in a bottle, but he says, you know, what do you want? And he says, I want millions of bucks. And then poof, there's all these Bambi daddies out there in the front yard. You got to be careful what you ask for. So this would be a serious thing if God were to say, what do you want? What do you want me to do for you? Well, you know, Solomon had that very thing happen to him. And so I want us to look very quickly at 1 Kings chapter 3. 1 Kings chapter 3, and you can just remain seated here because we're going to read quite a few passages back and forth. But 1 Kings chapter 3, God has gone in chapter 2 and he's asked Solomon, God said, ask, what should I give you? And Solomon replied in verse 6, you have shown great and faithful love to your servant, my father David, because he walked before you in faithfulness, righteousness, and integrity. You have continued this great and faithful love for him by giving him a son to sit on his throne as it is today. Lord my God, you have now made your servant king in my father David's place. Yet I am just a youth with no experience in leadership. Your servant is among your people. You have chosen a people too numerous to be numbered or counted. So give your servant an obedient heart to judge your people and to discern between good and evil, for who is able to judge this great people of yours? Lord God, we thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you for the passages that we will be looking at today, and we ask that you teach us what it is that Solomon asked for and that we ought to be asking for so our churches can be filled with Solomons in this day. Lord, show yourself today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, church, today, we as Christians have a daunting task before us. We are to contend for the faith in face of opposition. Opposition that we know is coming from the world outside. Opposition that we've learned as we studied the book of Jude, even coming from inside the church. Those that are in stealth, those that are in hiding, those that are false teachers. Yet, we are told that we are to advance the kingdom of God in this world. Now, can I tell you today, to do that, we need Solomons. We need Solomons in the church. And it's not just a good idea to have some. It's not just an advantage if we have Solomons. It is an imperative that we have Solomons in the church today. Last Wednesday night, we looked at the passage of Scripture that talked about the Ishkarites and how they understood the times and knew what Israel was to do. We need Solomons that understand the time by looking around, but also has the ability to know what the church ought to do. This is not something that can be left up to pastors or deacons and just say that's their role. As a matter of fact, churches need pastors that are Solomons. And there's a lot of guys out here doing this that aren't Solomons. They need deacons and elders and people, leaders in the church that take on that role as being the Solomons. But it's got to go beyond that. So I ask you, what is this thing that Solomon requested of God? Now the standard answer is what? Wisdom. Heard that all my life. As I've grown up in church, Solomon asked for wisdom and God gave him wisdom. But as I start reading the scripture, he didn't really ask for wisdom. He got wisdom, but he asked for discernment, the ability to discern. Discernment and wisdom are very closely tied together. They're connected, but actually discernment is a prerequisite to wisdom. Growing up, and I guess from the time that I first started hearing the term, and this was after I was an adult, because I don't remember ever being taught as a child or as a high school student anything about spiritual gifts. I guess I grew up in a Baptist church, and we were afraid if you started that, then there would be this tongues and all this stuff that we'd have to deal with. So we just, it seems like our church must have stayed away from it for some reason. But as a young adult, I started hearing this term, spiritual gifts. And it's very definitely in Scripture, and God has gifted each and every person that He has called to Himself. Each Christian, every Christian, is given a spiritual gift. And so, as you look at the Bible's explanation of what spiritual gifts are, one of the spiritual gifts is the gift of discernment. And so it was taught, when it first started being taught that way, is that you may or may not have discernment. It depends on how God has chosen to gift you. Everyone has at least one, and so yours may or may not be the gift of spiritual discernment. So if you carry that line of thought, there are certain people in the church that God's gifted to be discerning, and the rest are just left off the hook. They have another gift. And that's true. That's true while we're talking about spiritual gifts. But as I continued to study a few years ago, I realized that spiritual discernment is not just a spiritual gift. It's also a discipline, a spiritual discipline. You say, well, what does that mean? Well, let me give you an idea by telling you what some other spiritual disciplines are. Prayer. Worship. Service. Bible study. Those are spiritual disciplines. Who are to do those things? Isn't that for all of us? We're all to be praying. We're all to have that discipline of prayer. We're to have that discipline of Bible study, that discipline of worshiping God, a discipline of serving God through the church, and we could name others. So that means if we're all supposed to be, and we're all responsible for those spiritual disciplines, it also means we're all responsible for the spiritual discipline of spiritual discernment. And so we each have that responsibility as a Christian. Our text today, actually the one that was listed in your bulletin, is 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 14. It says, guard through the Holy Spirit who lives in you that good thing entrusted to you. Guard through the Holy Spirit who lives in you. The only people that have the Holy Spirit living in them are the children of God, those that have been saved. He gives us His Holy Spirit that indwells us. And He says that you are to guard that thing entrusted to you. Some of your versions say that deposit that has been made. So what is that? Well, it's the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's the word of God. It's God's revelation of Himself. It's God's good news. Folks, this is all we've got. It's not a religion that we're entrusted with. It is the very word of God. And He says that we have a responsibility to guard it through the Holy Spirit who lives in us. Paul is telling Timothy, the gospel that has been entrusted to me, I am now passing on to you. Not that he's letting go of it, but he's saying, not only is it my responsibility, but I'm training you up, Timothy, to have this ability to discern. And so you take this and you use it, and then you pass it to others. Don't let heresy erode it. Now, a short definition of discernment would be, and we can expand later, but be the skill of thinking biblically about life. We all think about life, whether you're checking your 401k or you're checking to see what the stock market's doing, or you're trying to decide how to raise your children, or you're trying to make decisions in life. We all think about life, but God's people need to be thinking about life from a biblical standpoint. See, the task of preserving truth is a difficult task and a demanding task, and it requires spiritual discernment and wisdom. Solomon asks for this, and Timothy indicates that it's also our calling. It's not just something we get to choose to do. But many people would look at that and go, you know, Pastor, we've got jobs, we've got responsibilities, we've got other things we need to do, so why don't you and the rest of the staff, and maybe if you can get a few of the deacons to help with you, you guys do that, and then we're not going to worry about that, we'll just trust you. Well, there is a cost for you not to have spiritual discernment, and for you not to be operating in that discipline of life. There are at least three that we're going. There's three we're going to talk about today. There's probably other costs, but the first one is the lack of discernment is evidence of spiritual immaturity. In Hebrews chapter 5, beginning with verse 11 through 14, it says, we have a great deal to say about this, and it's difficult to explain since you have become slow to understand. And he's talking to the children of God here. He's talking to Christians. And he says, for though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic principles of God's revelation. You need milk, not solid food. Now everyone who lives on milk is inexperienced with the message about righteousness because he is an infant. But solid food is for the mature, for those whose senses have been trained to distinguish between good and evil, or you could say to discern between good and evil. Now, Luke's not calling these Christians stupid. He's not saying y'all are just a bunch of stupid people. It's not what he's doing. He's not saying that they're unlearned. He's not saying that they're incapable of learning. He's actually saying you've become too lazy to understand. You haven't been practicing this discipline of discernment, and that you have become lazy in your faith. You've become dull of hearing. You've become so lazy that you don't hear what God is saying anymore. Phillips, in his commentary, says these people think that theology is a waste of time. You ever heard that one, Josh? I've heard people say that. Oh, we don't. I had a church one time that I was filling the pulpit for, and I was talking to one of the leaders in the church before I got there to kind of find out what I was walking into. And I guess at one point I wish I hadn't said yes before I found out what I was walking into, because his statement was, you need to understand, we don't do doctrine and theology here. I'm going, and dude, what are we coming? Yeah, I didn't say that. Guys, we do theology here, and you do theology in any church and doctrine in any church, because if they don't have a statement of faith and a doctrinal statement, you're doing the doctrine and the theology of the guy that's standing behind the pulpit talking. You can't do God's word without doing theology. It is a study of God. That's what Sam spent an amazing time in Sunday school this morning. Sam, great job with that of looking at Genesis. And it's not about creation as much as it's about God of creation. It is theology. And see, but people look at that and they go, well, we don't do theology. And here's one. We just prefer that everyone gets along. Now, we were in Virginia when Virginia went to two state conventions, and I heard a lot of that. Why are we doing all this stuff? I mean, can't everybody just get along? Well, we'd like to, but we can't compromise this. And so we have to do theology so that we're with those that are of like faith and order, those that believe the way we believe on the major important things, and there's room for things that we don't agree on, but some things are not up for grabs or not up for negotiation. And when people start talking about this, they use that passage of Scripture that says we're to have childlike faith. But they're living lives of childish faith. And there's a big difference in childlike faith and childish faith. Childish faith says, I want something that excites me. Childish faith involve people that are mesmerized with the bling of spirituality. If you can just put some bells and whistles on it and make it look classy and flashy, that's the kind of faith I want, they would say, because it's exciting. Childish faith is a faith that looks for the satisfying of our own appetites, and many times in worship it becomes triumphalism instead of true worship. Worshiping worship instead of worshiping the God who we are to worship. These folks would spend their time reading Bible passages and skipping over others because they're looking for the ones that make them feel good and happy, and choosing to ignore those that challenge and stretch their faith and stretch their spiritual walk. But folks, God wants us to be stretched. He wants us to have a discernment and a wisdom that as we dig in God's Word, it challenges us every day. God wants believers to grow and to get out of their comfort zone and to be mature in their faith, which is impossible without discernment, without distinguishing between good and evil. The second thing is a lack of discernment is evidenced of backsliding. In other words, the individual's faith is diminishing instead of increasing. We saw that in the Hebrews passage, and so let's just very quickly look at verse 12, the center of that, verses 12 and 13. He says, "For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic principles of God's revelation. You need milk, not solid food. Now, everyone who lives on milk is inexperienced with the message about righteousness because he is an infant." There's a lack, or there's evidence of backsliding. It appears that these people that the writer is writing to had been growing, and then the writer says, "You need someone to teach you again. You've somehow missed it." Reminds me of someone that is sick. You get to the place where you can't eat solid food, and you go to the doctor and you say, "Hey, doc, I just can't keep the solid food down. It's just there's a problem here." And so he does some tests, and then a lot of times a doctor will give you something like Ensure. I've never drank it, but it just doesn't even sound good. But you know, it's that stuff that they'll have you drink to build up your electrolytes and all those kinds of things in your body to help make you strong again, to get you to the place where you can have solid food again. So he's saying there's been this time that you were on solid food, but then for some reason you've gotten to this place where you need some spiritual insurer to build you back up, because you really ought to already be on solid food, and not only should you be on it, but you ought to be at a point where you're teaching other people these solid things. He said, but you're backsliding. You see, we are, as we said, to contend for the faith. And if we're going to contend for the faith, it takes constant practice of discernment. And if we don't have that, we begin to regress. Have you ever tried to go up a down escalator? I'm not talking about one that quit working and it's just a set of glorified steps. I'm talking about an escalator that's coming down and you've tried to run up them. Guys, you can make it to the top, but it takes work. And it takes constant movement. You've got to move faster than the escalator's moving down. And you know what? You can't plateau on an escalator that's moving down and you're trying to climb. We hear a lot of talk about churches that plateau. Well, let me tell you something. Christians cannot plateau. You're either climbing or you're regressing. Because we are on a moving escalator spiritually. And if I'm not climbing, and if I'm not exerting the energy to learn to be discerning and to get the wisdom of God and to grow in my faith, then I have stopped climbing, and just the life itself is moving me down spiritually. I say again, you cannot plateau on a moving escalator or in your spiritual walk. We've got to constantly be growing in our spiritual discernment. Third, the lack of discernment is evidence of spiritual death. Now, before you hyperventilate, I'm not saying that if you're saved, you can be lost again. The Bible teaches that you can't. Once saved, always saved, because you didn't save yourself. Jesus Christ saved you. God saved you. He did the work. There was nothing, Adam, that was baptized this morning, there was nothing that he did that allowed him to take his spiritual walk and save himself. God did all of it in him. And he did all of it in us. And so therefore, God has us. Because he said, that which is mine, I will not lose. So we can have confidence that we don't lose our salvation. So he's not saying that you're going to lose your salvation. But what I'm seeing here in this is that individuals who persist in life without spiritual discernment, without growth, are literally giving testimony of the fact that they were never true believers. So you can fake things for a while. You can get caught up in the excitement of religion for a while. But let me tell you, religion will leave you empty. It won't fill that void that God has placed in us. So religion itself will not fill you up and will not keep you going. So by their testimony alone, they were never true believers. They were along for the ride. They were playing the role, but never truly regenerated by the saving power of Jesus Christ. And you say, well, how do you base that biblically? A couple of passages among several we could pull. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. But the unbeliever does not welcome what comes from God's Spirit, because it is foolishness to him. He is not able to understand it, since it is evaluated spiritually, or you could say spiritually discerned. Have you ever talked to somebody, an unbeliever, and you start talking about things of God and things of the kingdom of God, and they just look at you like, I don't get it. I don't get it. And they don't. Because it takes the Holy Spirit to get it. Because it's beyond our human reason. And sometimes as Christians, we get so upset with people out there because they don't get it. And the fact is, God's word told us, you're not going to get it. Because until you are in Christ and Christ is in you, you're not going to have that kind of discernment. Because it comes from a relationship with Christ. Romans chapter 1, verses 28 through 32. That's a passage that many times is used to deal with the issue of homosexuality. And it's included there, but folks, it covers much more. Look what it says. And because they did not think it worthwhile to acknowledge God, God delivered them over to a worthless mind to do what is morally wrong. Now that's where we can say, oh yeah, see that, but look at the whole list. They are filled with all unrighteousness, evil, greed, and wickedness. They are full of envy, murder, quarrels, deceit, and malice. They are gossips, slanderers, God-haters, arrogant, proud, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents, look at this, undiscerning, untrustworthy, unloving, and unmerciful. Although they know full well God's just sentence, that those who practice such things deserve to die, they not only do them, but even applaud others who practice them. Folks, there's a huge penalty, a huge cost for ignoring discernment. And if you can go through life never growing in the faith, never growing in wisdom, spiritual wisdom and spiritual discernment, then you are demonstrating the fact that you were never saved. As one pastor put it, to fail to discern is to walk in darkness. and we don't have time, but I can pull out tons of scriptures that tell us that we are to be light, not darkness. And that we are to walk in the light of the gospel, not in the darkness of the world. But so we don't end on a downer today, plus so I can finish up my time. Y'all got used to a couple of weeks there. You got used to getting out early, and it doesn't happen all the time, okay? Listen, for us to be discerning, there are benefits of it. There are benefits of acquiring discernment. Number one, discernment is the evidence of spiritual life. The process begins at salvation. You say, Pastor, when should I start developing this spiritual discernment? The minute you're saved. You say, but wait a minute, I got saved a long time ago and I didn't, no one told me that. Okay, start now. I told you it was several years into my Christian walk. And I was saved at the age of 11, but I didn't realize and I didn't see in Scripture, and I'd never been taught that spiritual discernment was a discipline, so I just assumed if I didn't have it as a spiritual gift, it wasn't something I was supposed to do. And so I feel like I was kind of playing catch up, and that's okay. You might be in the same place, but there is this evidence of spiritual life as you start using the process of discernment. And it should develop and continue to develop all through your life. And you say, well, how do I get better at it? Same way you get better at any discipline, you practice it. I mean, we're all cranking up to, or many of us, to start watching college football. We've got high school football. Stephen, what do you have to do to be good? Oh, be dumb? Is that what? Oh, no. It's not just be dumb, put the helmet on and say, come hit me, right? You got to practice. You got to know the plays. You've got to know what to do. You've got to anticipate what the other team is going to do so you can react to it. That's what spiritual discernment's all about. Know what God's plan is. Know what God's word says. And then know what he says about the world, and then you can anticipate the moves of the world. That helps keep you from being caught off guard. We saw a great hit last Friday night. Thankfully, it was on their team and not ours. Number 33 was eating us up. And all of a sudden, he decided instead of running, he was going to catch a pass. That boy wished he'd have never gone out for the pass. He walked crooked off the field. See, he wasn't anticipating being hit. And I think that's what happens to the church. Sometimes we go, oh, you mean there are people out there that are going to fight against us? We need to anticipate these things, and we do it through spiritual discernment. This is evidence of spiritual life. Proverbs 9:10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. The more I know about God, the more I am in tune to who He is and His characteristics and His instructions, the better I'm going to be at discernment. Ephesians 5, 8 through 10 lays it out nicely. It says, for you were once darkness, but now you are light. It's interesting what he doesn't say here. He doesn't say you were once in darkness or you were once walking in darkness. He says you were once darkness, but now you are light. In other words, you are light in the Lord, he says, which means you're a believer. So he says, walk as children of light, for the fruit of light results in all goodness, righteousness, and truth, discerning what is pleasing to the Lord. There are so many that fall into sin, and I'm not saying any of us are exempt from it. I mean, that's part of spiritual discernment, to know that none of us are exempt from that. But recently, with all this Ashley Madison stuff coming up, and people's names being released because somebody knew how to hack in and release all these names, and there are pastors who had names on that list. There are leaders in our cities and governments who have names on that list. I've got a friend that pastors over in Farmersville, and he said somehow he knew how to get on to find that list, And he said in the little town of Farmersville, there was something like 290 some odd people on the list. Wednesday night, I just made the comment, I wonder how many would be on the list in Iowa Park. Somebody sitting in the group said 326. I think that was the number they gave. That totally caught me off guard. I looked and said, huh? And she said, yeah, you got to know how to get to the list, but you can get to the list. There's 326 people in Iowa Park on the list. I can tell you a name. It wasn't. I haven't asked for a copy of the list. But let me tell you something. What that means in a community our size is you know somebody on that list. You might not know they're there, but you know somebody. As Christians, we need to have discernment. And you might look at that and go, oh, well, that's a no-brainer. That's evil. Yeah, well, there were people that were saying that's a no-brainer and that's evil who got caught with it. Because our natural bent in our flesh is to move that direction. So we need discernment. Discernment is evidence of spiritual growth. There's two incidences that I want to point out that Jesus and his disciples had that illustrates this for us. The first one's in the book of Mark. Jesus has fed 5,000. He's performed various other miracles. He's fed the 4,000. And then in Mark chapter 8, he and his disciples have gotten in the boat and they've gone to the other side of the sea. And the disciples began to discuss, how are we going to satisfy this hunger we have? Now, I've looked at that before and went, duh. I mean, what did you guys miss? Jesus just fed 5,000 and he didn't have much to start with. And then he fed 4,000 and he didn't have much to start with. And now 12 of you are saying, how are we going to eat? And I'm glad I thought of it that way because Jesus kind of thought of it the same way. He scolds them and he says, don't you understand yet? What he's saying is where's your spiritual discernment? Don't you have any discernment and wisdom yet? I'm your answer. So here you've got 12 disciples that have missed it. But then if you go into Matthew, Jesus is teaching using parables. And as he teaches and he's sharing these parables, the disciples look at him and they say, well, Lord, why don't you just take these truths and just give them the facts? Just say what it is. Just bottom line, Lord, just tell them, you know, why are you taking all this time to go through the parables? And I love the answer that Jesus gives them. In Matthew chapter 13, 16 and 17, he says, but your eyes are blessed because they do see, and your ears because they do hear. For I assure you, many prophets and righteous people longed to see the things that you see, yet did not see them, to hear the things that you hear, yet did not hear them. He was complimenting their spiritual discernment, the growth of their spiritual discernment. He said, guys, you're getting it. You don't need the parables anymore. You've gotten to a place in your spiritual walk that I can just give you spiritual truths and you get it without having to have a story attached to it. So that's a sign it's a sign of spiritual growth. And the third is discernment is evidence of spiritual maturity. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15, but solid food is for the mature, for those whose senses have been trained to distinguish or to discern between good and evil. Healthy Christians have a living faith. It's growing. If we see a child who is not growing and whose growth patterns have become suppressed, we would say that child has a illness or there's something wrong. Yet so many times in the church we see Christians who have been stunted in their growth and we don't think twice about it because our expectations are for people to be saved, but we have nothing to say that it's got to grow. And we've got to understand that there's much more to salvation. Salvation is by gospel design connected to discipleship. And some of the proof of your salvation and the proof of your spiritual life and the proof of your spiritual growth and the proof of your spiritual maturity is the fact that you are moving beyond those things, important things, but those elementary things of salvation, and you're moving to a stronger walk. You're able to look at things and go, wait a minute, that thing that I wasn't expecting, here's how God's word deals with that. Now, there are times, you know, I think we ought to pray about everything. Some things you really don't need to pray about. I mean, if I'm sitting here and going, should I love Josh with a biblical love? The answer is yes. I don't have to pray about that. The Bible's already told me that. But in a lot of our activities, a lot of our decisions, there needs to be time in prayer. But the fact is, God doesn't care. If you're going to buy a truck, God doesn't care. God doesn't care if it's black or white or any other color. It just doesn't matter to him. But it could be an issue of whether you should buy a new one or a used one because of stewardship. Or it could even be an issue whether you ought to buy it now or later because of stewardship. That's spiritual discernment. That's using spiritual discernment in your everyday walk. But what we've gotten to where we live, and many Christians live the same way, if I want it, I want it now, and I don't want anything to have to wait. And I mean, I can justify getting a brand new one because I'm not a mechanic, but that's not necessarily a biblical stance to have. Okay, so there's discernment that plays out in the church, but the discernment also will play out in your everyday life. It's a sign of maturity. Healthy Christians have a living faith that grows and matures and brings honor and glory to the Lord. There should be something different about our decision-making process. And it's not discernment for discernment's sake. It's discernment for the sake of guarding the purity of the gospel that has been entrusted to us. And you say, but do those other decisions have anything to do with it? Absolutely. Because everything in our lives are on display for the world. Everything. And so, as Christians, we ought to be making decisions different than the rest of the world. We ought to be looking at things that are taking place in the world and understanding them from a total different perspective. That's what we've been talking about in our adult discipleship classes of how to look at what's going on in the world and look at God's word and say, how do we respond to this? And every issue that comes across on the national stage has a biblical answer. And a biblical place for us to stand. How many of you have seen War Room? Okay, several. Let me tell you, if you've seen it, you understand the connection of that to this sermon this morning. If you haven't seen it, go see War Room and you will understand the connection. We don't get spiritual discernment from anywhere other than spending time with God and in His Word. And that's what I saw as that woman sat down, not only just to pray, but to pray with her Bible open. And to pray reading God's Word and claiming God's promises. And the only way you can claim that is that you know what they are. And the only way you know how to ask God certain things is you know the character of God. And that's discernment. That's maturing in the faith. That's how we contend for the faith. And Solomon knew the importance of spiritual discernment. He describes it well in Proverbs chapter 2, beginning with verse 1. Proverbs 2, 1. He says, "My son, if you accept my words and store up my commands within you, listening closely to wisdom and directing your heart to understanding. Furthermore, if you call out to insight and lift up your voice to understanding. If you seek it like silver and search for it like hidden treasure, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and discover the knowledge of God. We are living in a time really no different from any other time in this call, but a time that God's people need to be exercising spiritual discernment. But we're also living in a time when I almost feel like the churches are more devoid of spiritual discernment than ever before, because we're not taking the time. And folks, if we've got to clear our calendars, if we've got to quit doing some things, then let's do it. So we have more time with God in His Word, asking Him what Solomon asked, Lord, give me a discerning heart. And God will be faithful to Himself when He gives us not only discernment, but wisdom. You say, yeah, but Solomon messed up. Yes, he did. But he started out right. So if you want to look at his mess up, that's just another reason for us to grow and mature in spiritual discernment. Don't make the same mistake Solomon made. It starts with the fear of the Lord.